so difficult to see you again. And, I mean, I can't even talk. It just, you know, it just drives me crazy.
Yeah.
Sorry.
I actually know a lot of people that were like,
do you really?
Yeah, we did theater. Rich Kleinberg, who plays the Blue Man. Uh-huh. And he works with my brother.
People ask about the Blue Man all the time.
Yeah,
I had no idea.
Yeah, I think he did an interview for some podcast talking about it. He said he still has some prosthetic thing from the Death Scene that got cut.
Oh, you know, wherever John Wayne was,
He's been in contact with so many people.
If anybody wants to go on the tour, we're going to be doing it at 8 o'clock at the Red.
Is her brother?
No, he works with my brother and I've been there.
Is that Kim? Kim, isn't it? I didn't know that. Oh my gosh. I love the Beverly Housewives.
Where should I sign?
Wherever you want. No, I don't, but I will do PayPal. But that's, you're wanting one of these?
Oh,
no,
yeah, I'll get one of those.
Oh, all right.
Can I get a picture?
Debbie Bernstein. This movie was filmed in just 1 month. It was filmed in September of 83 through October of 83, and that's all it took. There was a lot of extras in the movie, which some are here. Raise your hand if you're an extra. There we go. Yes, let's have the extras come up here. The movie was almost, let's see, it was filmed in 83, so it's almost filmed 40 years ago. Does it feel like 40 years ago? No. Cool. But there was a lot of, like, there's a lot of extras in the movie. I mean, there was a lot of corn in the movie. There was a lot of painting corn in the movie with green spray paint. I just want to say thank you. Thank you so much for being here. Kenny, thank you so much for letting me be here.
But without further ado, I'm going to let this man right here do an introduction to the film, and then we're going to watch Children of the Corn.
Look, they're the reason we're here. And that's the cool thing. It's not because what I was able to do, but Kenny and John, man, give them applause. These are heavyweight dogs. So I'm thinking about when you said, would you talk to everybody before the film? I'm thinking, what can I say that's important? Because I'm just a dumb, tall kid with a starchy shirt. And I thought, here's a funny idea about this, because it's kind of the oxymoronic thing about the film. I was really proud of this as my first film. And I went, when I lived in Venice, California, to a theater that was showing the film, and there's the marquee, Children of the Corn. Fuck, that's me, that's it, I'm it, you know, it's really cool. And it was in the area where there were a lot of second-run movie houses where they would run the film for $1.50 or whatever, and it catered to the retired community of Santa Monica at the time. So I excitedly stood there, and I'm thinking, oh, this is really cool. And a woman just walked out, retired woman, came from the theater, And I said, hey, what do you think of this? And she said, oh, it's just awful. It's just awful. These kids with their knives. I don't. And she went on, and I thought, oh boy, there goes my career. I'm down the drain. But it made me realize how cool it is to make a film and how to come back here and to see all the things that we just more or less, which we will talk about after we see the film, made up on the day. There was a lot of planning into the film, but we made up a lot of things that made the film work and particularly fit into the community to make it look the way it looks. So I really do hope you enjoy it. I hope you see things in it that you will ask questions about and we can better define them, but you see things that are familiar and you see some of our stars that are in it that are here with us tonight, and you just have a good time. I think it's cool. So eat popcorn, let's laugh, and let's giggle at the silly lines that used to be scary. So it'll be cool. So I hope you all enjoy it. Thank you for being here. Watching, listening to your responses, your laughter at some of the stupid lines in the movie, she's out cold. I didn't do it. I came up with a bunch of dumb lines in this movie that I'll admit to, but not that one. That's the funniest thing in the world. Of course she is, you know? But in making a film like this, you just hurry and you're not thinking, and you say just to the actor, say this, not thinking that that's what we just saw happen. So it becomes redundant and funny and all those kind of things. But I'd really like to answer any questions you have about what we did, our process, how we made it, how we came here, anything you can think of, certainly. So,
how did you get involved in this project to begin with? Was this just hey, this is my opportunity, or were you a Stephen King fan?
I didn't know Stephen King from my mother. Oh, I'm sorry, that didn't sound right. I mean, I knew of Stephen King's literary achievements, certainly. But I was making television commercials at this time. And one of the men that worked for me and my business partner, who's the producer, Terry Kirby, took the job at the company that was the studio for this film. And he came one day with a bunch of stories, scripts, and said, please make a movie. You can do it. We want to make movies. And you two, my business partner and I, knew how to do it at a reasonable cost, a budget. So that became the incentive for us to take on, plus my particular professional incentives and desires to be a motion picture director. So I said, sure. And we really didn't talk about fee or any of those things. I didn't care. I just wanted to make a movie. And so after discussing it with the executives, literally about 2 days later, we got in airplanes and we flew around Texas and Indiana and Illinois and came here and met a man who was a film commission man for the state, if there was such a kind of position, and he took us for steak dinner and beer, and we decided we'd come here. So that was it. Plus, this was just a terrific place. I mean, it has everything, as you can see in the film. It has the threat of the corn in the small town, and everybody wanted to help us, and they closed down the town for us and let us run around and put corn stalks everywhere, and it was just, the town was wonderful. So, you know, it's part of the movie. Mm-hmm. That was it? Well, thank you. Thank you, Whiting. Thank you, Hornet. Thank you, Salix. I don't know about those hot guys. Anyway, sorry, just kidding. I cheer for OU, so sorry.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, you too and your mother, okay.
How about the fire at the end of the movie? Did you talk about how hard it was to film fire? Was it shot on site, or did you do that in L.A.?
Oh, no. That's here, and John Sullivan knows exactly where we burned the cornfield. But that was a purchase. In other words, we bought from the landowner the right to burn the crop. We, the bomb itself, the explosion that goes up five stories, was a request of mine of the special effects people. We'll call them the pyrotechnicians because they handle this kind of work. And they dig a cylindrical hole in the ground and fill it with trash bags of gasoline. And so we used 50 gallons, I think, of gasoline in trash bags that last for maybe 25 minutes before the gasoline eats the plastics. So it's a very quick process, and you have to wait and wait and wait, and then suddenly, okay, we're ready to go. And stationed around it a number of cameras to capture the different angles. And the idea was we were going to make two pops, two blow-up, two explosions that night, and then let that fire burn and capture the images of the fire burning with other cameras. So it was, for us, the expensive night of the film, a lot of things. And traffic was stopped and people came out to picnic and watch this big fireball go on and all kinds of things, but it was really cold. And so we organized it so that filmically, if you don't move the camera and you stop it, and then you move something that you are photographing, and then you turn the camera on again, it jumps. It just goes boom, it moves. Or because you don't move the camera, it continues as if it happened. So the goal was to do that trick. We'll blow it up twice, never move the cameras, and we'll get two explosions that we can superimpose that'll be really big. Well, it was really cold, and the pyrotechnicians thought that brandy was a good idea. And so somehow, between them and the camera guys, the cameras got moved. So in one shot, the explosion goes up this way, and then the second take, the explosion's over here. So you can't really superimpose them. So it was really frustrating. So we hired a man to draw fire on those explosions and the face. And he was terrible. And it's not my fault, you know? And this is before really cool digital stuff was available. So he literally drew on film, kind of, and did this process, and that's what we ended up with. But we did burn that cornfield. And it was really big. And I'm sure some of you around here know. Yeah.
I remember it.
Yeah, it was a nice thing to watch. Yeah. And I wasn't very happy because, to me, with all the pressure of getting this big pyrotechnical event to happen, the day was over. Okay, it's time to go home. It's midnight. And the producer, the studio guy said, oh no, we have until 6 in the morning. Let's keep shooting stuff. Yeah, right. So, but yeah, on we press. But it was fun. That was a really cool spectacle. Yeah. The man in the red shirt has a question.
Do you remember if that was really John Franklin's voice?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, that's really him. The voices that we replaced, this is interesting. I mentioned to Kenny while we were watching the film. The voices we replaced were some of the driving sequence dialogue because it didn't sound good enough for the film, so we had to go into a studio and synchronize the voice with a new re-recording by Peter Horton and Linda Hamilton. And then in a couple of other places, but the voices of the children are done by a group of what they're called loopers. They come into the studio, they're actors, mostly comedians, and they watch the film as we've watched it with microphones set up here, and they choose characters on the screen and they become that character and they do a voice for that character. So you record about 8 people talking and then you blend that into the background. And if you remember in the cornfield with the kids, to give a sense of society to this group, this culture, I thought it would be really cool that we would have babies, older children, adolescents. So it turned out in the group was Bart Simpson, the voice of Bart Simpson, and she did all the baby voices, all the crying and everything in the film. This was before she had Bart Simpson, Angela Cartwright. So it was really cool to see these people go to work and create all of that. But that's the only time, I think, to answer your question.
Yeah.
What was your thought?
How did you do that part where the earth was moving and facing you?
That's the earth moving is just me walking around and being the god that I am. You know? Does that sound wrong? Should I say that? I'm kidding. So we're out in the cornfield, and the challenge is to come up with something scary, and I have no damn idea what would be cool for the monster. And every night I would think, ah, how can we make this monster? Because I told him that I can make a monster out of the air and the space and the things around us. And I really didn't know. And standing in a farmer's, I shouldn't say farmer's, but on a farm, I saw a wheelbarrow and a tractor. And I thought, fuck, there's the idea. Let's take the wheelbarrow apart and use it upside down, the hump of the metal, and we'll dig a trench and build a train track out of wood and weld wheels on the wheelbarrow and then tie cable to it and run it down into a pulley on the ground and then run the pulley over and tie it to the tractor. So the tractor would take off and the track went like this and then it went up and then it traveled and then it went back down. And the hump of the metal upside down wheelbarrow created that movement. So there is plastic over the trench and vermiculite soil on top of that. And so that gave it this whole kind of wave action, and it cost about $1 to make. So I was real happy, and I thought it turned out great. And I would say that the distance of the wheelbarrow trough was from me to you. It wasn't very long. And we used different angles to make it look like he ran 100 yards. So it was cool. Then there was another shot, I'll tell you this, that when the monster is coming at them, after we understand it's in the ground and it's this entity that's just an intangible, spooky thing all around us, I wanted the monster's point of view of all that stuff that's in the sky. So I had the crew, the guys, get the tractor again and weld a big cow catcher on the front made out of pipe. And they attached that to the tractor, and we put the camera behind it, and the bottom of the frame is the bottom of the front pipe, and we just drove the tractor into the cornfield. And you watch it fall down in front of you, and you get this sense that the monster is coming. And again, it was just, I don't know, try that. Let's see if it works. It turned out to be good. So somebody else had a question. Yes, sir.
When you did commercials, did you ever have to direct kids? And if you did, how different was it to direct kids doing very adult, very violent things in this movie?
Yeah, I did a lot of kid commercials. And maybe the reason I got to do a film with children, and then my next few films were with children and other things, and then I got a reputation. But when you make a television commercial, the advertising agency's the power. They tell you what to do. And the client, the agency's client, the people at Pepsi-Cola tell the agency what to do. So the stage mothers and fathers of the children are unbelievably protected in TV commercials. So they are constantly asking you questions, and what do you do? And you have somebody say, I always had people with me to take them for a walk, is what I would say. So the mom or dad would come up and say, oh, well, my child has been here for 22 minutes and you haven't done anything. I'd say, oh, meet Terry. Terry would show you the croissants we got today. And then just walk them away so we could film. So they were much more demanding, but there are rules, state laws of California for labor for children under certain ages, and we had to abide by those rules. So we have extras that are the double for the characters, the children, and we use them intermittently so the children could go to school, have recreation, work with us for so many hours, and their days were properly maintained. But TV commercials, a little more, they get in your name. I still like them. They're nice. What else can I answer for you? Oh, I'm sorry. Pretty close to it. Thank you for using the word big. That's a good adjective. It's huge. It's huge. Linda had made one film before this called Tag, which was about kids at UCLA who played a game of tag, that game we played as children, touching each other and running away. But they used little dart guns, those harmless little guns that shoot a dart. And the idea was once you got tagged, it was a kind of an, I don't know, initiation into fraternities and things. And so she had no depth of background. And Peter had a, what were we talking about, John? It was the Peter's film before this, Seven Brides for Seven Brothers, the TV movie version of it. And we saw him and we said, oh, he would be a wonderful person to be part of the film. And he was easily persuaded. He loved it. I think he said, I met Fritz and he acted like a child, and that sounded fun to be around. So it was kind of neat. That was it. Everybody else, pretty much their first film. Are you going to ask a question? I cut you off. Yeah.
Oh, what happened to Joseph's body? Is it in the trunk or is he roadkill?
I don't know. Joseph, that's something.
I think he's still in the trunk.
To this day, we're looking for that child. To see what it's all about. Child services are all over my houses. I've been moving constantly to stay away from child services because they, you know, this child Joseph. He's a well-known photographer in Seattle. Is it? Is that where he lives? Yeah. He's turned into quite the artist. He's really neat. But one of the silly flaws of the film that we hope the audience never understood was the, you know. We didn't quite tie the bow up on a dead body in a trunk filled with corn. We hoped the explosion would be the spectacle, not the autopsy. What else can I answer for
over
you?
Over here.
Yes, sir.
I'm an Iowa Hawkeye fan, just throwing that out.
I love them. You can't get any better than Iowa Hawkeye fans.
So, Isaac and Malachi, did they ever go on and do other films?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Malachi and Isaac, further film work?
Did they go on?
Oh, yeah. I think we can come up with a list of films. Isaac, maybe, I mean, he was in Adam's Family, and as we were talking about today, and a number of other. Courtney has a unbelievably good filmography, if you want to call it that, of things like
The Burbs,
Hard Bodies, Memphis Belle. I did another film with him, or two other films with him. He's terrific. He's still acting today. He lives in East Coast, and he'll get a small horror film, and because of his stature in the horror industry, if you want to call it an industry, genre, he'll come in and play a role. He's terrific. Terrific. Everybody's done, you know, pretty well. Everybody still works. Even Robbie Kiger, we spoke to him on the phone today, and I said, "Where are you?" And he said, "In the back of a police car." And I said, "Well, you must be working, because I hope you're not in the back of a police car." Yeah. What else can I answer? I'm sorry. Of course.
I'm a bit short.
But you're still kind of funny.
How much corn have you been through with this time?
How much corn? The question is, how much corn did we go through on this film? Gosh, I really don't know. It was an enormous amount that was propped around the city, around the town, in the car, in the houses. It was constantly being used. I think there was a truck filled with it that the prop people and set dressing people would draw from to stage and dress the rooms or the houses or the locations. But it was constant, and corn was a constant problem because it was dying. So you didn't see it closely, but I can point to the scenes in the film where it's painted, or it's rubber, or it's not real corn, or we used one stock up close to the camera so it looked like there was a whole field and things. There was a lot, you know. But everybody let us, like, you want to run a car through my cornfield? Sure, you can do that. And we came to an agreement, and everybody was wonderful. Sure, this is kind of fun. Courtney came in, and as you're familiar with the process of making film, you talk with a lot of actors and you do auditions. And so they come in, and usually the process is we just talk. Because I'd like to see what you are like as a regular person before you take on a character portrayal and you start to act. So some actors come in prepared and they don't want to talk to you and they want to just do the reading. They want to play the scene out with whomever. In this case, Jeff Greenberg, the casting associate, would read one part of the scene, and the actor auditioning would read their side of the scene, it's called. And Courtney came in, and he had the long, scraggly red hair, and he was intense, and he just like he just pulled hubcaps off a Chevy. He was so pissed. It was really cool. And the producer wanted to chat with him, so we immediately stopped talking to him, just let him do his work, because he's all intense. And Jeff, I think it was the scene in the film where Malachi challenges Isaac. You're a non-believer. I'm going to take you out. And gets angry and pulls a weapon on him. And they start to struggle in a power struggle kind of thing. And so Jeff is close to him as we are doing the scene. And Courtney, out of nowhere, pulled out a machete about this big and whipped it up on his neck. And Jeff just, that's it. I quit this business. These people are crazy. I'm out of here. I'm done. I won't do this anymore. He was furious. And I said, wow, Courtney's great. He gets the role. This is really neat. Violence against casting people. It's kind of one of my watches. But he was genuinely just in tune with everything. He had been trained as an actor who believes in a certain process. And so he brought it to the audition in a very strong, really convincing manner. Yes, ma'am. Mm-hmm. This was my very first feature film, yes. Yeah. And then it went downhill from there. Oh, man, are you kidding? I just love you. But, yeah, it's just, no. We made others after that. But this was the very first one, and as I mentioned, what a chance to make a film. I mean, the Earth and the Moon and the stars don't always line up for people who want to make movies, and this time it did, and I was right there, and I was just lucky, and things coordinated, and they said, let the tall guy with a starchy shirt go do it. And so, yeah, it was just an exhausting experience of 20-hour days for about 6 months. And it was tough, but boy, it was fun. And I really, how many years now? 38 years. And we're still watching it. It's fun. Mm-hmm. Same as I am today, 29. I think I was 31 when I made the film. So I started making commercials out of university. So I was 22 when I went to Los Angeles and kind of slept in the car to get jobs to make TV commercials, and then eventually worked my, I was a camera assistant, then I was a cameraman, and then I started my own production company making TV commercials, and did that for about 2 years, and then got the opportunity to make this film. So we were all punks. We were just kids. It was just so much fun. Dewey, yes? What we didn't expect was we're not agriculturalists, is that the right word? So we came to look at Iowa and chose it in July, and then came back in September and went, oh wow, it dies. They harvest this stuff. Where did it go? And so the challenge really was every day finding the sea of corn that was green enough for us to photograph as a background or in which we photographed. But we found that one side of the street would be green and the other side was gone. It had been harvested, and it literally in 2 days. So each night it was almost like a joke. What's the corn chip today? Wow, tomorrow's location's gone. We'll have to send somebody out to find a new place. So what can we do in exchange for what we had planned to do on that day? So that was really the big eye-opener. And I think the hospitality of this of the cities, really. We had complete control of this town. Nobody could come out of their businesses. Everybody just said, sure, you want to make a movie, I'll watch. Everybody was just wonderful. That was kind of unexpected, because in Los Angeles, when you make a film, commercial, anything, you go into a neighborhood, and people are so savvy with how the process works, knowing, for example, that sound is recorded, and it must be quiet so you can record the sound properly. So they, in their yard next door to where you're filming, run their lawnmower. And you go over and say, here's $100, would you stop lawnmower? So everybody has their hand out. And here, people said, you want a pie? I said, okay. So that was kind of unexpected. And when I heard that he was available, there was no question. Could he come and do it? It would be just like having a great, and you wanted to hang out with him and ask questions and understand about the history of cinema, because he's lived through Hollywood for so long. And he was just a wonderful man. And just whatever you want to do is fine with me. I don't really care. You don't tell someone with that stature how things work. So he developed the limp and the whatnot and the kind of archaic, broad acting that he did in the film. But I'll say this about the acting. One of the goals in the theory of making the film was to honor the cheap B-movie. So we knew we didn't have any money to make a film with all the slickness that you can make this film. with. So let's do the things that we're familiar with in the conventions of B-movies. So the acting is a little bit stodgy and theatrical and grand, and the camera work and some of the lighting is just not perfect. And so it was more a tribute to that genre, horror, low budget 60s movies. And so we tried a lot of that. But it has nothing to do with R.G. Armstrong. It was just he fit in well with our concept of how it was supposed to work. But he was great. I wish he was alive today. You should watch some of his work. He's a pretty cool bad guy. Yes, sir.
One more thing. So when you do the next Children of the Corn, you do a proper sequel or entry, when you revisit it again, please don't kill the dog.
Don't kill what?
No. Don't kill the dog.
Oh, no. Isn't that stupid? I mean, who did that? I had nothing to do. I wasn't even there that week. I would never, you know, no animals were hurt in the making of this film except a dog. The dog, the death of the dog purely was for the emotional impact on an audience. Let's make this man sympathetic. If he loses his best friend and it's a dog, everybody will think that the children are awful. Mm-hmm. You know, like the woman who saw the movie after I saw her. She's awful. No, I wouldn't do that. How did we make a movie out of 15 pages?
Story.
That's pretty much the genius of Fritz Kiersch. I don't want to take credit for it, but that some bitch knows how to do 15 pages like it's 100. He will bore that audience with unnecessary filmic garbage and to stretch. Here's the story of the script. It was first put together by Stephen King. It was his idea. He thought that that short story would be a wonderful film, so he wrote a script. But he is a novelist and he's not a screenwriter. It's a completely different type of writing, completely different. And no one cared for what he wrote. And so he eventually got to Hal Roach, the man who started the Little Rascals, who had this idea at his age, 80 so, that he would reinvent the Little Rascals and this film would do it. Let's make the Little Rascals mean. So he tried to sell that, and the group at New World said, this is an interesting idea, but we don't want Stephen King and we don't want Hal Roach, so let's buy them out. So they paid them not to participate in the film and hired George Goldsmith, the ultimate screenwriter, the eventual screenwriter, and he then compromised the story to make it good. And I sat with him and the producer over Saturday and Sunday, and we took these giant scissors that were about this long that you use on fabric, and with one swipe you could cut the width of a page of paper, and we would just went in, we chopped that out, we took that section, we pasted it next to another with scotch tape on a piece of paper, and we built the script, basically a combination of what George had figured out and how to stretch it and bring this idea of the relationship between the heroes not working very well and the little kids having their own storylines and the Stephen King original idea. So it was really a quilt. That's what it came from.
Did you work with Stephen King at all in this?
No, not at all. He wrote a letter that I got to see 6 months after the film came out, saying, this is awful. Again, I think he knew the woman at the theater. So, but he was not very appreciative of the work that we did to his original idea. And I completely understand it because it's really predicated, his opinion's predicated or motivated by this disregard that he got from Hollywood. So, no, he didn't have anything to do. I will say this as a stupid anecdote. I was in Pennsylvania in a little tiny town near Pittsburgh. And it's an idyllic, beautiful little city, little town, and there's a bookstore there, and there was a poster on a shelf in the window that said Stephen King will be here. Oh, all I want to do is meet him. So I went there. This is genius Fritz Kiersch. I went there on the Monday that said on the poster, Monday, Stephen King will be signing, because it was covered up. I get there to find out that it was a Monday about 2 months earlier. And I felt really stupid, but I had this energy to meet him because I'd like to hear his point of view and to say, I'm the idiot that ruined your story. And see what he thought. But... Yes, sir.
At the beginning, did Linda Hamilton know that it wasn't a dummy under the seat?
Oh, no. No. That's one of the cool stories of the film that we get to talk about. And again, it's me getting in the middle of something that I shouldn't have done, but it turned out to be a positive outcome. And that was an idea on the day, saying, knowing she was going to walk on this approach, left, right, from the car, up to the dead body under the cloth, and that she was in a mode of performance of grief. And so she had worked herself into this state of sadness and this sorrow, and she was by herself. And I talked to the assistant director and said, here's what we'll do. Get the kid, and we'll show her the dummy, and she'll go off and grieve and build up her emotional intentions and her acting chops and all those things, and then we'll slip the Jonas underneath it. And so he was there for the whole walk, and I was to give the command now, and he was going to sit up and scare her, and that's what he did. And that's her real reaction, that she leapt back. And after we yelled cut, I remember the language that came out of her mouth. It was really exciting. But then she really liked it. She thought it was the greatest organic approach to a performance that she was ever been allowed to do, because she didn't have to worry about how she would feel. She just felt it, because she was completely surprised. She had no idea. It turned out well. Guys, I'm going to get back to Kenny, but thank you very much. Thank you. I just want to thank you guys.